So a very good afternoon to all of you. Today we'll be having the class on gingival surgical procedures. So from this class we would like you to know the gingival surgeries, explain all the gingival procedures which are associated with the surgical techniques, apply various surgical techniques, compare all the surgical techniques pertaining to the gingival tissues, and complete the curettage procedure under the guidance. So this is a clinical procedure, the last one, so you have a quota of root cleaning which would include even your curettage along with it. So to start with, we'll go on with the contents. Introduction, curettage, we'll be explaining about curettage, about gingivectomy, gingivoplasty, apical displaced flap, and then we'll finish it with conclusion. So to start with, periodontal pocket reduction surgery is limited to the gingival tissues only, and those which are not involving the underlying osseous structures without the use of the flap surgeries can be classified as gingival curettage and gingivectomy. Current understanding of the disease etiology and therapy actually limits the use of both these techniques, but their place in the surgical therapy is essential. So we will go on with the first procedure, that is curettage. So the word curettage is used in the dentistry or in the field of periodontics to scrape out the gingival wall of the periodontal pocket to separate the diseased tissues out. So here you can see that this is the gingival wall which is present of the pocket. So this is scraped out with the help of a curette. So this is termed basically as curettage. So there are three types of curettage present, so which we do actually. So first is your gingival curettage, where there is removal of only the inflamed soft tissue lateral to that of the pocket wall. Whereas the second one, that is the subgingival curettage, is performed a little apical to the epithelial attachment, severing the connective tissue attachment to the osseous crust which is below. So basically this is little further downwards when compared to the gingival curettage. And the there's another term called as inadvertent curettage. So this is a term which we generally do when we are going to do our root planing. So some degree of curettage would be done unintentionally during your scaling or root planing. So that is called by the term inadvertent curettage. So what is the rationale of doing curettage? So generally curettage is being done to remove this chronically inflamed granulation tissue that forms the lateral wall of the periodontal pocket here. So the purpose is valid, particularly when you need a good attempt to make it to give a new attachment back to the tooth, especially in case of the infrabony pockets. And sometimes many authors, they have questioned this procedure, whether curettage is essential or not. So why have they questioned the procedure is that they found out that when root planing was done, the major source of the bacteria disappears and the pocket pathologic changes resolve completely, with no need for the next procedure of curettage. They also found that the existing granulation tissue also slowly resorbs. The bacteria which is present there, in absence of proper nutrients, are destroyed by the defense mechanisms itself. And therefore, the question of curettage, whether it is required, this procedure is required or not, is a big questionable thing right now, procedure right now. But we basically do this procedure for the purpose of getting a new attempt to make the new attachment, especially in the infrabony pocket regions. So what is the aim of it? It is to eliminate the periodontal pocket by enhancing gingival shrinkage, new connective tissue attachment, or both. It could restore the gingiva to the normal health with respect to color, contour, consistency, and surface texture, to eliminate the inflammation in very deep pockets before doing any surgery, to reduce the loss of attachment by developing new connective tissue attachment. Indications would include to eliminate shallow suprabony pockets located in accessible areas and an inflamed edematous pocket that would shrink to the sulcus depth after the treatment, as a part of new attachment attempt in moderately deep infrabony pockets in inaccessible areas, basically a closed surgery. Generally flap surgery is of two types, that is open surgery and closed surgery. So closed surgery is mainly done in certain cases where it is difficult to open the full area and debride it. Probably the patient could be a person of uncontrolled diabetes, which where open surgery is contraindicated. So in those cases, just a curettage of that area would be sufficient to bring back it to a normal status. The third indication includes, as a non-definitive procedure, prior to the flap surgery to reduce the inflammation, or in patients who need more aggressive surgical techniques and are contraindicated due to age or systemic problems, as maintenance treatment on recall visits for areas of recurrent inflammation and pocket depth. So contraindications would include where the pockets have a tortuous course. Like here you can find a little spiral pocket which is present. So if it is a tortuous coast pocket like this, try to avoid it, because it will be difficult for us to place the curette all through this way up to the furcation area. And when the opening is narrow and the base is broad, or when the molars are little tilted, and when it is a when the soft tissue wall is fibrotic in nature rather than edematic, if it is fibrotic, or if it is because of the drug induced nature, that is hyperplasia, if the patient is on dilantin sodium, that is your phenytoin for epilepsy. So in those cases, try to avoid this, and focation involvement. Systemic contraindications include history of blood dyscariasis, diabetes, or any other debilitating diseases, drug history, patient on corticosteroid, allergy to local anesthesia to be avoided. So coming out of the procedure, the basic armamentarium, as the name of the procedure suggests, it would include the set of 7 greasy curettes. So 7 greasy curettes according to the area used to be taken into account, and local anesthesia, a surface anesthesia for superficial curettage, and deep infiltration for the deep curettage would be required. So before doing curettage, thorough scaling and root planing has to be done. So during this procedure, you might do a little bit of inadvertent curettage too. Then give little local anesthesia to the selected area, and decide on the type of curette to be selected. Like you do have certain numbers of curettes which can be used on the anterior area, and certain number of curettes which can be used on the posterior side, facial and lingual aspect, and the interproximal aspect. So select on them, and then insert the instrument so as to engage the inner lining of the pocket, and is carried along the soft tissue, usually in a horizontal stroke. The pocket wall may be supported outside by a gentle finger pressure on the external surface, so that when you are removing this area, this removing the inner wall of the pocket, the other external tissue doesn't slip away. So just apply little finger pressure on the external aspect to keep it on proper stand here. And after this is done, wash the area especially with saline, and then tissue is partly adapted to the partly adapted to the tooth by means of a finger pressure. Suturing and pack if needed is to be done. So here you can see the diagrammatic representation where there is removal of the pocket lining, and then the second step, there is elimination of the junctional epithelium which is there, and the remaining granulation tissue, and this is the completed procedure. And after it is done, we are just going to fix this back to this area by means of suturing or pack, or just by means of pack. Now coming on to other techniques, there are other techniques or certain modifications to this basic technique. So one technique is your excisional new attachment procedure, otherwise known as ENAP. So this procedure is nothing that the previous procedure is done with the help of curettes, but this procedure is done with the help of knife, that is, an incision is being given. So this is a definitive subgingival procedure performed with the help of a knife. After adequate LA is given, mark the pocket with the help of a perioprobe, and with a surgical blade, give an internal bevel incision from the gingival margin to the point, apical to the point below the pocket, carrying it in the interproximal on both the facial as well as the lingual side. So see, the main words or the key words here is your internal bevel incision apical to that of the point where the pocket is ending. So that has to be taken into account, and then remove the excised tissue with the help of a curette. Root planing is done to remove the etc. Items here, that is your deposits which are there here, and then irrigate this area. Approximate the wound and recontour the bone if necessary, and suturing and dressing only if needed. Next, coming on to the procedure, ultrasonic curettage. It is mainly done by using ultrasonic devices. So here the ultrasonic vibrations may disrupt the tissue continuity and lift off the epithelium. This results in a narrow band of necrotic tissue and decreased inflammation and less removal of connective tissues there. These instruments are not as that effective as hand instruments in removing the connective tissue and leaving a smooth pocket wall. The third procedure is your chemical curettage. So this is just an alternative to your regular curettage. So use of caustic drugs such as sodium sulfide, alkaline sodium hypochlorite or phenol has been used. These were disregarded after studies showing their ineffectiveness. Not only that, the authors also had a trouble that the extent of the tissue destruction cannot be controlled. They also found that there may be increase rather than reduction in the amount of tissues to be removed by enzymes or phagocytes. So because of all these factors, this procedure by means of chemicals is not being conducted right now. So curettage by using laser fiber. So this is a very frequently carried procedure here nowadays, where the fiber tip is slowly inserted into the pocket. First, initially you insert it at long axis to the tooth surface. So this is a painless procedure. You insert it at long axis to the tooth surface up to the most apical region of the pocket, and then try to vaporize this region and pull it out. So once this is done, the calculus which is there on the root surface is removed by means of your scalers, and again you are going to introduce the laser for vaporizing the remaining pocket epithelium, the subgingival plaque or some granulation tissue if it is present, and then readapt it back to the tooth, and then you can see the healed surface which is there here. Now coming on to the healing after curettage, immediately after curettage, a blood clot fills this pocket area. This is organized into a granulation tissue. More amount of neutrophils on the wound surface and dilated capillaries are present. There's rapid proliferation of granulation tissue. Tissue maturation may be there, but there are small blood vessels which are occurring and which will start to form. And epithelialization of the sulcus starts taking 2 to 7 days. Authors, when they have found whether debridement and curettage, if they had any effect, they had tried to compare studies if only debridement and debridement and curettage if done in patients, which is providing more benefit or results. They found that there was no significant differences when compared to only debridement therapy, that is only when scaling and root planing is carried out, and another procedure where scaling and root planing and curettage is carried out. So they had no differences between these two procedures, and the healing was by means of a formation of a long junctional epithelium, and this was an uneventful healing. Now coming on to the clinical appearance after curettage. So immediately after curettage, as all the procedures, the gingiva appears little hemorrhagic and bright red, but after 1 week you could see that the redness is slightly redder than the normal, with the apical shift in the position of the gingiva. So here is a 1 week procedure where you could see the shift in the marginal gingiva present, and after 2 weeks your normal color, contour, consistency, surface texture and gingival margin, which is well adapted, is seen. So you're basically going to give an appointment to the patient for curettage, that is after finishing your curettage is after 2 weeks, to check if you have done your procedure correctly and removed all the irritants correctly, and put him on supportive periodontal therapy later. Now coming on to the complications. So the main complication which we dealt was with these patients is the development of sensitivity. Assure the patient that it will disappear as the denuded roots gets a new attachment and junctional epithelium is being formed. If it doesn't disappear by few days, then prescribe desensitizing toothpaste, localized application of 8% of zinc chloride, 10% strontium chloride, 5% sodium fluoride. Pain on percussion may be present in some patients, because of the inflammation in the periodontal ligament fibers, and bleeding also can occur in some patients. Okay, the next procedure which we need to see is about gingivectomy. So this is a procedure, as the name tells, that gingiva, and you're going to remove and cut off and throw off one part. So as the name suggests, it is the excision of the soft tissue wall of the pocket. It is a procedure for the eradication of the pocket by removing the diseased pocket wall by surgery. It is a surgical procedure designed to resect the gingival pocket in such a manner that the remaining gingiva will heal to provide health, function and aesthetics. So this can be performed by means of scalpels, electrodes, lasers or chemicals. This is considered to be the most reliable and predictable method of pocket elimination, because you are totally going to eliminate the tissue itself and throw it out. Now coming on to the objective and the advantages of the procedure. So the main objective is to eliminate the pocket, achieve a normal architecture of the gingiva, provide visibility and accessibility. And coming on to the advantages, provides visibility and accessibility for calculus removal and smoothening of the roots. Technically, it is a simple procedure. There is good visual access and complete pocket elimination is possible. Predictable morphologic results are there. So, but there are certain contraindications to it. We will see it about later, but first about the indications. So mainly, if a person is having gingival enlargement or overgrowth which is caused by medicaments or hormonal related, then you can go in for gingivectomy procedures. Idiopathic fibrosis, suprabony pockets in areas with limited access, elimination of suprabony periodontal abscesses, and certain minor corrective procedures. So aesthetic procedures can be done with the help of your gingivectomy. But it is contraindicated completely when there is going to be a narrow or absent attached gingiva, when there is going to be infrabony pockets, thickening of the marginal alveolar bone, situations in which bottom of the pocket is located apical to the mucogingival junction, aesthetic considerations, particularly in the anterior maxilla. So all these cases, it's basically contraindicated. Now coming out of the disadvantages, so this has very limited indications, and then the post-operative pain in this case, since it's going to be a raw bed, it is going to be little severe, and healing is by secondary intention. There's a danger of exposing the bone. Supposing if I remove this part of my gingiva and if my bone is present very close to it, I have a danger of exposing my bone here. Sacrifice of the attached gingiva is more, and sometimes it could expose the cervical area of the tooth, leading to sensitivity, aesthetics and caries. Phonetic and aesthetic problems in the anterior area could be another disadvantage. So after the gingivectomy is being done, there are certain desired results which is needed. So if you are able to achieve these results, then go in for this procedure. So what are these results which you need to achieve? So you need to get a thin gingival margin which is beveled and adapted tightly to the tooth, a pyramidal shaped interdental gingiva confluent with the gingival margin of the adjacent teeth, and the interdental gingiva which is present should be sloping to 45 degree and have a linear indentation to have a sluiceway occluso apically, and the remaining attached gingiva, zone of attached gingiva, should be adequate and it should be keratinized. So if you find that you can get all these results after your gingivectomy procedure, then do the procedure on the patient. So you have to analyze whether this procedure can be done before going in for the procedure. So what are the instruments which are used for gingivectomy? Your basic instrument, that is your probe, mirror and tweezer, syringes, hypodermic needle along with LA, and a pocket marker is needed to locate the base of the pocket. So this comes in a pair, and then you do have gingivectomy knives. So you can see how the knives are placed. So the this is the Kirkland's knife, and this is the Orban's knife, and this is the universal knife which is present. And then it BB blade with blade numbers 11, 12, curettes, tissue scissors and tissue nippers are required. You can also do electrosurgical method of gingivectomy. So for that you need an electrosurgical unit, and the tips of electrosurgery, the tips are required for it. So basically, this coming to the surgical technique, there are four major steps which have to be done. First of all, you're going to mark the pocket. So what is meant by marking the pocket? So pockets with are explored with the help of periodontal probe first, and then they are marked with a pocket. So your pocket marker is something which has a straight end like this and a curved end like this. So the instrument is held with the marking end in line with the vertical axis of the tooth. The straight end is inserted to the base of the pocket inside, and this curved end is then inserted on the outer surface, and this is done by pressing. So the straight end is inserted into the base of the pocket. The level marking is done by means of pressing these pliers together so that it produces a bleeding point like this. So here you can see the clinical picture where it is inserted, and this plier is pushed over this area so that you do get bleeding points like this. The pockets are marked beginning on the distal surface of the last tooth, and then you are moving anteriorly. Each pocket is marked at several places to outline the course of the each surface. So here you can see the diagrammatic representation where the pocket marker is placed in position. The second diagram, we will be seeing it in the next step. So the second step is about the resection of the gingiva. So this can be resected with the help of periodontal knives, scalpel, scissors, or by means of electrosurgery or even lasers. You do have two different knives, as I told you earlier. One is your Kirkland's knife, which is being done for the facial surface, which can be used for the facial and lingual surface, and your Orban's knife, which can be used for the interdental aspects. So BB blades 11, 12 and 15 can also be used for this purpose. So we will see how we are going to do our incisions in the next step. So basically, before going to the next step, you should know how to make your incisions. So incision is started at a point apical to the point which we have marked your pockets. Like, it is started apical to the points making the course of the pockets. Incision should be as close as possible without exposing the bone. So you can see that we have placed the incision, but it is at a distance from the bone level. This is beveled at 45 degree to the tooth surface, and an external bevel incision is done. Same procedure is repeated on the palatal aspect also, but for better contour and to avoid blood vessels and nerves of the incisive canal, the incision should be carried out along the sides of the incisive papilla and not horizontally across it. Now, there are two types of incision which we will be doing. So we will see how it is with the help of the diagrammatic representation. External bevel incision is being used. So discontinuous incision is one in which it is started on the facial surface of the distal angle of the last tooth, carried forward along the course of the pocket, following the course of the pocket and extending to the interdental gingiva, and then it ends on the distal facial angle of the next tooth. The next incision begins where the previous one crosses the interdental space. So this is kind of a discontinuous incision. Individual incisions are repeated for each tooth to be operated. So on the other hand, continuous incision is one which is done on the facial surface of the last tooth, and it is carried forward without any interruption. This is again following the course of the pockets. Basically, there is no interruption here in case of continuous incision, whereas in case of discontinuous incision, you do have interruptions which are present. Now, the third step is your removal of the pocket wall. So after you have done your incisions, you are going to remove the excised pocket wall, clean this area and closely examine the root surface if there is going to be any calculus or any other granulation tissue which is left out. So it was found that the most apical zone consists of a band-like light zone where the tissues were attached, and coronally to it, some calculus remnants, root caries or root resorption may be found. Granulation tissue may be seen on the excised soft tissue. So here you can see a diagrammatic representation where after the gingivectomy procedure was done, you could see a little bit of granulation tissue, you could see a little bit of calculus which is present, and this is the clear space where the junctional epithelium was attached previously. So it is our responsibility to remove this calculus before we are going to send the patient. So the fourth step is to carefully curate out the granulation tissue from this area and remove any calculus and necrotic cementum to leave it smooth and clean. So fourth step is basically scaling after tissue removal, and you can see the gingivectomy wound which has been present after the scaling has been done. So this represents in total what are the steps in the gingivectomy procedures. So again, for your explanation, so this is the planned area for the gingivectomy. We are going to mark the pockets with the help of your pocket marker having bleeding points when you are going to press the plier against the gums. And resection of the gingiva is done by means of Kirkland's knife and the Auburn's knife. Kirkland's is for the facial and lingual aspect, Auburn's is for the interdental aspect. And then you're removing the tissue and then you're examining the surface. So after the examining, if you find calculus, you're going to scale it, or scaling is being done. So you can see the clinical view immediately after gingivectomy, and this is the post-operative view. Now, as curettage is there, there are certain other methods for this also. Like, there are certain procedures other than the incision by means of blade or knives. So you can do it with the help of drugs, or you can do it with the help of laser, you can do it with the help of electrosurgery. So to start with, we will check out with the help of chemosurgery. That is use of drugs. Some chemicals have been advocated instead of knives and blade. Use of 5-paraformaldehyde incorporated in modified zinc oxide eugenol pack placed at gingival margin in pocket is being used. Another method uses the potassium hydroxide, but the main disadvantage, like the curettage, is that the depth of action is not controlled. Gingival remodeling cannot be done, and epithelialization reformation of the junctional epithelium is lower in chemically treated wounds. This procedure is generally not recommended. Gingivectomy by means of electrocautery, it permits adequate contouring of the tooth. So here you can see an electrocautery device, the tip is present. It also helps in better control of the hemorrhage. The main difficulty with this is that you cannot use it in patients who are non-compliant or having a non-compatible or a poorly shielded pacemaker. It can cause unpleasant odor because tissue burn is there. If it touches the bone, irreparable damage can occur. Heat generated can cause tissue damage if not used properly. If the electrode touches the cementum, it produces areas of cementum burn. Now, healing after gingivectomy. So the same way as your curettage, the first thing is that a protective clot is formed. This clot is replaced by granulation tissue. At 24 hours, increase in new connective tissue cells just beneath the surface layer of inflammation is present. By the third day, numerous fibroblasts are seen and highly vascular tissue grows coronally. By 12 to 24 hours, epithelial cells starts migrating over the granulation tissue. Epithelial activity peaks at around 36 hours. Cells migrate by tumbling action. Surface epithelialization completed by 5 to 14 days, and complete repair takes by 7 weeks. So see to that in case of curettage, the complete repair takes place by 2 weeks itself. Here you are removing a tissue completely and you are expecting repair to take place. So here it is going to take 7 weeks. So next procedure is your gingivoplasty, which we will be seeing. So as this name indicates, plasty, it is just artificial reshaping of the gingiva to create the physiological contours. This is termed as gingivoplasty. So this technique is similar to gingivectomy, but it is different on its purpose. Gingivectomy is mainly done to eliminate the pockets, whereas gingivoplasty is done with the sole purpose of recontouring the gingiva in the absence of the pockets. So here there are no pockets, but we need to remove this gingival enlargement. So we are just recontouring it, that is, we are just removing the upper part of it and reshaping it so that it is not hindering the appliance or the appliance, and patient's adequate plaque control is being achieved. This can be done with the help of knife, scalpel, rotary coarse diamond stones or electrodes, or even lasers. It creates loose ways for passage of the food. After the flap excision has been, flap has been elevated, the tissue from the inner aspect is being removed, and then you can see that
this enlarged portion has been removed, and then the flap is then adapted back to the alveolar bone and it is sutured, and we wait for the healing to take place. So to make clear about the decision treatment for drug-induced gingival enlargement, so here I am talking in terms of enlargement, how we are going to decide for treatment, either if you want to go for gingivectomy or you want to go for a periodontal flap. So this applies to almost all the enlargement, not only drug-induced enlargement. So supposing if you know a person who's known to take drugs which could cause a gingival enlargement, check out if enlargement is not present or not present. If the enlargement is not present, well and good, call them for oral hygiene reinforcements and professional recalls. If it is present, oral hygiene reinforcement, chlorhexidin, gluconate rinses, scaling and root planing, possible drug substitutions and professional recalls are required. Reevaluate them after that. If the gingival enlargement regresses, well and good, maintain good oral hygiene and professional recalls. If it persists again, then a periodontal surgery is indicated. If it is of small areas of enlargement, that is when there is no attachment loss, only horizontal bone loss, and abundance of attached tissue is there, then go in for gingivectomy procedures. But if it is large areas of enlargement with little bit of osseous defects and limited keratinized tissue only, then go in for periodontal flap, and then put the patient on maintenance therapy where good oral hygiene, chlorhexidin gluconate rinses, professional recalls, and use of positive pressure appliance is required. Consider periodontal surgical retreatment if the the gingival enlargement is recurring again. So my conclusion is based basically on the indication which is more for the chapter which we have seen today, that is enlargement. Recurrence of chronic inflammatory enlargement immediately after treatment indicates that all the irritants have not been removed. So basically our scaling and root planing has to be correct if we don't want this recurrence to occur. Contributory local conditions such as food impaction and overhanging margins of the restoration are often overlooked, but this has to be also corrected. If the enlargement recurs after healing is complete and normal contour is attained, inadequate plaque control by the patient is a common cause. So removal of the irritants stands as prime factor to avoid the recurrence of the pockets and the enlargements. Okay, thank you.